I want to start out here with my example, and I'll use some of those concepts and a lot simpler ways to use them and synthesize the activities as we go through that. So I'm going to go ahead and look at a DFR, design for reliability process. What's the best process out there? Well, if you're designing something and you're looking at reliability, design for reliability is what you really want to be looking at. I'm going to take something very simple and just kind of illustrate the concepts on a simple product, simple design. So for that, I'm going to end up building a chandelier. So to keep things simple, I'm going to assume that my entire effort is around building a new chandelier. If I'm a company and I'm building something, where does it fall in that? And in one scale, I'm going to ask, how new is it to me as a company? How new is it to the market? That would be my axis. Basically, if you're building anything that's evolutionary rather than revolutionary, in other words, you had version, you built something like that before, and you're going to do the second version, make it better, you're really, it's neither new to you as a company from a design perspective, neither new to the market. Now, if you're up here on the top two quadrants, new to the company, that means you've never built that before. Okay, it makes life a lot harder because I have no knowledge, no tribal knowledge, no information, no data to start from. So I'm going to purposely put myself up there. So just to summarize that, it's my first development project. I have neither knowledge nor data when it comes down to reliability, so I'm only going to focus on reliability at this point. So I'm starting out with a blank slate. In doing so, I'm going to start at the design phase, and the example is going to go through all of that. I'm going to go through concept, design, development, testing, manufacturing, and support, and I'm going to follow a DFR process. I'm going to use our generic DFR map of how I would go through that, and you'll see different activities as I go through that, and I will go through each one of these activities in the example. A couple of things I'm going to point out here. First of all, the time scale on this is not something that you basically is to scale. A couple of other things that you cannot very well do is it is really not a linear process. You're going to go back and forth. You're going to keep on switching. You're going to come back. Unfortunately, from a teaching perspective, two human beings, I got to kind of linearize it. Next thing is I'm going to spend 85% of my time in this example here, at the concept phase, at the design phase. Isn't it cheaper to change a design or address something here than addressing it over here? So the more I catch over here, the more work I do here, the better off I am. At the same time, it's interesting to point out that I'm going to look at it from a design perspective. In other words, I'm making the product. See, if I'm a process guy, I own a refinery. I don't make anything. So I don't design the product. Basically, I'm using products I just bought from somebody else. I could also apply a similar process into what I call asset performance or asset management. And I've got a different chart on that. A lot of the things are a little bit different, but from a concept phase, they're pretty much very similar. Different terminology as we go through that. I'm not going to spend any time on this, otherwise we'd be here for a couple of days. I'll spend most of my time on the first one and kind of go through this. So let's start going through the process. Okay, so I'm going to start out with putting my DFR plan together. Obviously, this is not going to work for everybody. It's a template. What I would do is go in and look at what you do, and I'd put together a plan of how I'm going to get from point A to point B. As I go through the process, I'm going to start revising this. I'm going to keep on updating. I'm going to keep on changing it. The way I tell people is kind of like looking at a trip. I'm going to start in Los Angeles and go to New York. You know, you pull out the map, you draw a road map, that's your plan. Now, you could be going through Wyoming and the kids want to go see Mount Rushmore, and that wasn't in your plan, but you might head up to South Dakota and go do that. You adjust your plan. Within that, and if you say what's next at ReliaSoft, we're spending a lot of time on this particular aspect of it on the planning side, because to me it's huge. We're actually including a lot of tools within the platform itself to basically address the planning aspect of it. If you try to use what we have, or if you use our planners, a lot of it is gate-based. My child would do development. I've got different gates, and I move through gates. What was important to me that we didn't really find anywhere else, if you try to do that, and that's why we decided to go that route, is that as you go through gates, your gates should be driven by actions. And that's pretty much how I wanted to drive it. If I've got actions, actions need to be completed within a gate. If they don't get completed within a certain gate, then the gate doesn't move forward. And that's my management philosophy. A lot of it is if I assign actions, let's say an FME, I'd make them part of this planner. And I'd make sure they're in the gates, and I make sure I got visibility at upper management. And I would also make sure that they get completed within wherever they need to get completed. So if I was going to do my chandelier, the first thing I would do is I'll go pick out a planner, and I'll put a plan together. And again, it's going to follow what I'm doing. And once I put that in together, I'll go ahead and just customize it the way I want to customize it, but I've got steps and I've got dates as to how I'm going to move forward. Now again, as I said, I like things being gate driven. If I add actions, they adjust the gates. So if they adjust the gates, dates get adjusted, so I've got full visibility on everybody else. If I deploy that as an enterprise platform, which is a synthesis platform, the only time it gets activated is when you start connecting different software to the same project, then things turn on. So if I use it that way, I get a lot more visibility across it. So actions assigned to me, and let's say apply to me doing some particular analysis, will show up in that software as an action. So I know I need to finish it. If I complete it there, it'll end up showing completed on my DFR planner and so forth. Some of the other stuff you have, if you deploy this as an enterprise version, we've also got, and this would require IT setup, but in this particular case, you could set up an enterprise portal. That to us is a huge project, is where I want managers to see where you're at certain aspects of it, what actions are being followed through, which ones are completed, and so forth. Start with a plan and keep readjusting that plan as new information comes in. Step two, I'm at the concept phase. At this point, I want to also start looking around and see what information I'm going to need once I put the plan together at later steps of the project. And start at this point trying to gather that information that I'm going to find useful later on. In other words, start looking at, you know, some new stress conditions, competitive product assessments, material properties, whatever I need, I'm going to need later on. I need to start thinking about that at this point. In my case of the chandelier, yeah, I'm going to go out there and look at, you know, what are the things that are going to affect me? What are humidity levels across America? Temperatures, disturbances, flicker limits, voltage fluctuations. You know, identify what I'm going to need later on in other steps, and I either get it or kind of figure out where I'm going to get it or figure out I don't have it and I need to get it. So how would I use it within our stuff? I mean, again, you could have anything. Could be links, could be documents, any type of documents you have. I'd put them in the planner. The way I've been doing it is, that's part of my step. I can go and associate whatever I need to associate with that. So I've got them at a centralized location. Everybody can find them. I can use them later. Let's start getting into another thing over here. And to me, this is huge. So spending time here, what I'd want to do is make sure I understand as much as I can, what are the stresses my product's going to see once it goes out in the field. It's not only the obvious ones. There's other stuff, a little bit more humorous of, you know, how we don't understand some of the usage environment. So I went out there and grabbed a television ad. It's by a bank called HSBC. This one talks about different cultures, so let's just go around that for about 30 seconds.
Sprzedajemy coraz więcej pralek w Indiach. Dowiedz się dlaczego.
Indiach?
Ina mina rika!
Ina mina rika!
Daj Dominika!
Daj Dominika!
Maka naka naka!
Maka naka naka!
Pika pika rika!
Pika pika rika!
If you're going to do business internationally, you should be with a bank that knows about international business. HSBC Commercial Banking spans 64 countries and territories around the globe.
Look at this. With your machines, I make 10 times more lessons than I used to. Have it?
Your business success is out there. Is your bank?
So it goes back to, how is the customer going to use it? You know, you may have an idea how you think the customer is going to use it, but at the end of the day, a customer may end up using it totally differently than your expectation. Of course, you could always make the argument that, hey, I never made it for that. Well, guess what? You want to sell to the market? If you want to sell to the market, you better think about it. So again, it's, do we understand what it is? Especially on most consumer products, consumer equipment, I've got really environmental conditions and I've got usage conditions. Okay, do I understand what the limits are on those environmental conditions and the usage conditions? If I take something, again, as simple as a washing machine, I've got temperature, I've got humidity, I've got water quality. Do I understand what that is? Okay, I mean, just a very, very simple question is that you guys live in the Midwest, and most of these things are made in the Midwest. Where do you guys put the washing machines at? Basement? Does anybody drive around Phoenix? Not too many basements. You know where they put the washing machines at?
Garage.
Not even a garage, because there are not too many garages. They're called carports. Okay, so they're in the carport. Okay, now carports exposed to the environment. So you got dust, you got heat. Have you considered that usage environment? And if you haven't, what are you going to do? You're not going to sell to the Southwest? I mean, you cannot do that. You need to understand what those are. You need to design for those because that's a customer usage profile. You start going into the usage. How's a customer going to use it? Okay, if you got a single guy that does laundry once a month, is pretty much going to stick whatever he can stick in there and just push it with his foot and try to close the door, and that's my laundry. Okay, you got a family of four, they're going to basically be doing it a lot differently, especially if they got kids. Do I understand what those parameters are? What are the limits? Other things on usage, I mean, that sounds simple. How you sit on your chair and take a look around, people are sitting on the chair, you're putting different stresses on that thing. Do you understand the full stress profile on those chairs? How you choose to sit on that will cause different failure modes. Do I understand the extent of that usage profile? You guys familiar with Herman Miller? Aaron chairs? Actually did that with those guys. And they actually had computerized chairs. They put about 200 of them in different offices all over the country. And they're basically logging data so they can actually build profiles as to how you sit on those chairs and what the stresses are. Because if you don't understand that, how are you going to test it? I mean, I'm just going to go push it up and down. I'm going to assume everybody sits in the center of the chair. That doesn't give me the right usage profile. So do I understand what that is? And then you'll find out that it's also distributed. Okay, it's not a constant value. So I'm going to end up working at the tails of the distribution. We really don't care about what this is. Okay, kind of care about over here is where you're going to have your problems. So for my chandelier, let's go back to my chandelier. I'm understanding what the temperatures variations are perhaps. Say I went back 100 years. Okay, I can go as low as 80 degrees, minus 80. 1971, Prospect Creek, Alaska. Okay, if I want to sell to that market. And I'm sitting inside Death Valley about 129, cold 130. Okay, so I know at least over the last 100 years, these are my limits. So let's say we're sitting during the concept phase, and I've got my fancy designers over there, and I've got the guys that come from the art group, and what they're saying is that we should make a chandelier that's basically, let's do it out of raw steel, looks modern, industrial. Okay, so maybe one of the things I may do up front is, hey, I've got corrosion as a concern, and say primary driver's humidity. I have a lot of the observed data already during the prior step. I captured a bunch of humidity data. Understanding what that is, I may choose to go ahead and take some of that raw steel, take some coupons, and do some coupon testing. Okay, and maybe I do some accelerated coupon testing and try to figure out how big of a concern is that. One way to do that is, let's say we have expected lifespan of, let's say, a year or whatever that happens to be, that's under warranty. You know, what's the reliability for the time span? What's the probability we'll actually have something that's going to corrode, that's going to come back through the warranty channel? So I could simply go through that, take the data, build my humidity distribution, take my accelerator data, extract a set that shows how they would fail or how they would corrode, go ahead to my stress strength type of an analysis, and then through that be able to kind of figure out that based on the accelerator test, based on the usage conditions I have, what I'm looking at is about 85% reliability. Is that acceptable? Okay, probably not. It shouldn't be. Basically, you're saying 15% of them will rust if I deploy them in the US by just putting raw untreated steel. That goes back to the design people and say, well, you know what, maybe we need to treat the steel, maybe we change the design to stainless steel. But those are decisions you start making up front, kind of understanding what the impact's gonna be from that perspective. So as an example, one of the things I did here, I had my data in my planner that I had earlier. Got my humidity already embedded. So one of my steps was to go ahead and do that, so I assigned an action item. What I'm going to try to do is figure out what that reliability is based on, let's say, the humidity data I have. I'll assign it to myself. I may attach other information if I want to. So now that becomes an action item assigned to me. Now if I go over to Alta, I'll find out that that action item's there. I could just basically open it up, grab whatever data I need from that perspective, which is already attached to that, to the action item itself. And then once I have that, it's just a matter of going and building the models really quick. I'm going to use Weibull and Alta together. I'll go in Weibull and build the stress distribution. And then I'll build my strength distribution out of my, so that's my usage data, humidity. So that's my stress. And then I'll go to my corrosion accelerated life test. I went ahead and did it with relative humidity. So once I put that together, I can extrapolate a strength distribution out of it. So I'll go ahead and do that at a given time. And once I've done that, then it's just a matter of going through and looking at my strength analysis, both of those data sets, and again, come up with a value. So at least now I'm quantifying things And I'm saying, hey, if that design choice may have this effect, do we change that design choice? So again, a lot of these activities I do up front. Now in my case, I've got some parameters. Let's say I understood what the stresses are, being temperature, humidity, voltage fluctuations is pretty much what I'm looking at, and I understand what those limits are. Next thing, requirements and goals. This becomes important. I mean, if I'm gonna go start designing for something, I'm gonna do a lot of work on designing for reliability, I gotta have a target, right? What am I designing to? A lot of us kind of use metrics, and we love metrics, and we toss them out there, and different metrics. One of the biggest things is that, do we all understand what the metric is? What the metric means? And also, what's the relationship of the metric to business decisions? You go pick up a bulb from the shelf, and it says life, 750 hours. What does that mean? Okay, you're a reliability guy. What do you think that means, as a reliability guy? I'm guessing that's mean time to failure. If you're a housewife, what's your guess? What does that mean? It's gonna last 750 hours, ain't gonna fail before that, right? If you're a manager, what do you think that means? It's gonna last 750 hours, it's not gonna fail before that. So do we all understand what the metrics are? And do we understand the context of those metrics? And is it the right metric? Now, again, depending on what industry you're in, there isn't a single source where you get a metric. I mean, sometimes if you work for an OEM or you're supplying to an OEM, they come down and tell you what that metric should be. You could go in and find out what it should be based on customer preferences, benchmarking, best practices, costs, safety and regulatory, et cetera. So I said, depending on what world you live in, you have different sources of what that target is. I mean, OEM driven, you know, that's what I want you to do. That's your target reliability. Somebody signed the rank contract and that's what you're gonna deliver, that's what you're gonna deliver. Some of them are safety based, regulatory driven. This is what I'm gonna end up doing with my chandelier. I'm gonna basically look at the customer and look at costs. I'm not driven by anything. I have nothing regulatory or nothing that I'm gonna worry about, competition driven. So again, different sources. For my chandelier, I'm gonna go use a cost-based approach. I'm gonna say, well, if I design it and it's very, you know, I can make it the most reliable, but it's gonna cost me a lot of money, then I could afford to lose some, it's gonna cost me less money. And I'm gonna go through a cost-based, maximized profit type of an analysis. So by putting in some estimates, and I'm gonna end up with about 95%. And that's my target for about a 1 year life. Now, at this point, it's gonna be some of the most crucial things I'm gonna end up doing, and it's gonna be my change point analysis or risk discovery, and I'm gonna call it two things, and also my FMEA. The truth of it is I would do both of them at the same time. Okay, so they will both be simultaneous activities as I go through that. What do I mean by change point analysis? Let's kind of talk a little bit about that alone as a concept, is that if you've got an evolutionary product line, so I'm gonna go from design A to design B, okay, where there's a lot of similarities. What I really wanna do is understand what are the differences between what I had out there and what I'm putting out here. Why do I wanna do that? Well, truth of the matter is that if you've had something that was fielded and worked, reliability was acceptable and worked fine in the field, and if nothing has really changed, would you expect the reliability to change? Not really, okay? Again, the statement being that the change in reliability is gonna be a function of design and or manufacturing, environmental or usage stresses that change. If none of those has changed, the inherent reliability shouldn't change. So basically in prioritizing, what I really wanna do is concentrate on where most of my issues are gonna be from a reliability perspective. If I understand what that change is, it's easier for me to find it, okay? Where the changes lie is where my problems are gonna lie. Rules of thumb, 80% of your problems are gonna lie in the 20% that changed. If I know that, then I know where I'm budgeting my time, right? And this is where I'm going to. Part of my DFR planner is to budget my time. Just to give you a little bit of a look ahead, in this process, by the time I get to actually having a prototype built, I should know 80 to 85% of everything I need to do during the development phase. I should have planned for everything. So part of what I'm gonna be doing now, a lot of it is a planning exercise. First thing I would do to do this is I would start out what I'm going to call a reliability system hierarchy. Okay, I want to look at it from a hierarchy level. I've got a frame, I've got a wiring, I've got a bulb and a socket subsystem, and under that I got a bulb and a socket. You'll notice on that I don't go down to nuts and bolts because I really don't care about the nuts and bolts at this point. Okay, what I want to do is bring this down to a level where the lowest item in here is going to be my lowest actionable item. So I want to basically stop at a level where I'm going to be taking actions at. The next step I want to do is to either a change point analysis or a risk discovery analysis. It's the same thing. If I don't have anything to compare it with and see if it's changed, then I'm going to do a risk discovery exercise. Make sense? If I have a prior design that I can compare it to, then it's really more of a change point analysis. Then what I'm going to do is go through the change point analysis, which we have a few different ways to do it. The way I'm going to do it is pretty much through a set of questions. Does it involve new technology? Have there been historical problems with this item? Is there a potential safety issue if it fails? The idea is if I put this comprehensive set of questions together, is that if I went through every single one of them and I've answered no to it, I'm fairly confident that I really don't need to be doing that much more reliability work on that specific item on that tree. I would also say get management to sign off on it. That's your CYA. Because at the end, you're not going to do any work on it because you've went through this process. This would be the same thing if I had an existing item. If there's been no changes at that component level and that component doesn't have any interactions with anything else, that would be part of my questions. Do I really need to be worrying about that? Fair? So I'm going to go do that in my case. And I got a whole set of questions for my chandelier. I mean, there's about 40 of them. And on some of them, I'm going to answer yes. Yeah, is there a safety issue for the wiring? That's a safety issue. Usually stuff like safety issue, I'd put them in there. I'd take a look at it further. I've got those flags from that perspective. I'm going to end up doing further analysis on it. Again, if similar systems exist in the field, the other things I will be doing right now, before I even started with my DFMEA, if I've got chandelier version 1 already out, then you know what? I'll start bringing all that data from what happened to that one. If I had a fracas system out there that had the information, I'd go to the frame and I'd say, hey, bring in every failure mode we've seen in the field for the fracas system, from the fracas system for a frame. This now starts pre-populating my start of the FMEA. Instead of going in there with a blank screen and 8 people that sit around and try to brainstorm, I'm going to actually end up making the exercise more of looking at things and deciding if those are applicable, making it a lot quicker, and reusing information as I go forward. So I may go through that and I might see different failure modes on there. Then maybe I want to bring them in there and put them on the frame for the FMEA. And then again, try to look at, are there any additional ones I want to put in there? Other things I could do, if I have existing information already, let's say I've got an FMEA for the frame that was done in the prior, I'd start bringing in occurrences that may have happened in the field. Because a lot of times when the prior one was done during the design phase, right? Now, I'd want to keep matching those and see, well, how many of those actually have occurred? And I might find out, well, that failure mode, I've seen it 9 times. And again, I'm linking that to my fracas system and updating those counts as I move forward. What I'm going to start doing is start looking at my design FMEA. And this is going to end up being one of the most important pieces in the puzzle as we go through this. Now, if I'm going to go, I'm going to start out with my reliability system hierarchy, as I said. That's going to become my driver. For that, I'm going to try to, for each one of these components, what I want to know, as I said, is how do they fail? How will that fail? What are the causes of that failure? What are the consequences of that failure, the effects? I need to know that information, and that's crucial. Okay. Now, if I've done this before, I will bring in all the old ones. Okay. I'll go out there and say, what do I know about wiring failures? Whether even though it's a different design at this point, let's bring them in. Let's see what I know about it. And then I'd rather know and say this doesn't apply than not consider it. If I've got a fracas system out there that all of those, I've got a live link on them, I'd start synchronizing all the failure modes from there, bring in what I haven't seen. As an example, let's go look at it from multiple ways. If I've done the FMEA first, and then I'm basically going to set up the fracas system, I could basically suck in all of my FMEA into the fracas system, so I've got a startup for people that are going to be using that system to make sure they identify things with the right items, right? So I could do that pretty easily. So now I've got my chandelier in the Fraga system, as well as included whatever failure modes the original designers considered. Okay, so now that precedes that. From another perspective, I could go the other way. If I had an existing fracas, I could go in and suck in the chandelier right away in the same reliability system hierarchy, along with all the failure modes that I've seen in the field. So that kind of starts my FMEA. Or the other things I would be doing as I go through that, if I've got both systems running simultaneously, what I'd be looking at is if I've got an FMEA and I've got a fracas system by item, I want a way to compare and see what's here and what's not here. So again, by having it this way, it becomes really easy for me to start comparing items and cross-correlating where things are at. So ideally, I should be able to come in here if I had both systems and catch 90% of what's out there initially, and then use whatever time I need in that FMEA meeting to come up with stuff that nobody else might have thought of, or things that are not in there, or do new deliberations versus 100% of it. Let's start from the beginning. Okay, so in this particular scenario, what I would do is look at what else is in my fracas system, that being red, that doesn't exist in my FMEA. Green ones in this case are identical. Yellow ones means they exist, but there's textual differences between the descriptions. I don't want to make sure I synchronize all of those. So in this case, again, I could go through that and look at each one of the components. I'm going to look at my frame, wiring, bulb, and socket. And again, I could have multiple teams work on it at the same time, or a single team. In FMEA, we're moving towards a hierarchical view because, again, it's all about the information. It's not about the spreadsheet. If you do want to do it with a spreadsheet, we still have that option in there. Might not be in there for many more versions, but again, I'm trying to capture information. How will something fail? And then, once I got the information, I can sort it 20 different ways. I can look at it from different perspectives. Okay, and I'll start doing that in just a second over here. Let's say I'm still interested in the printed one and I've got one. I can do that. I can print it in any format I want to. So let's say in my case, I've got four FMEAs. I've got one done for the frame, one done for the wiring, one done for the bulb, one done for the socket. Okay. And let's say I've used standard XYZ and it looks like that because that's the columns I chose to include. Another thing we do today is we kind of look at them as singular items. Each one of them kind of stands on its own. To me, it's really all of them are joined at the system level. Because I want to look at them all from a system perspective, not necessarily from a component perspective. If I take a traditional approach, I'll go through and compute some RPNs. Then I'll use those to rank things, and then I'll set up action items to basically eliminate some of those. So that's fine. That is what we do today traditionally. And what I'm going to do by doing that is I'm not going to catch everything, right? I'm going to catch a certain amount. So it's the first filtering scheme. As I add action items here, I'd make sure those action items, I have a way to follow them. In my world, if I stack them in the planner, then that pretty much assures that I have to follow that process to get it done. If they're more complicated, I may choose to go through an AD process to try to address those actions. If you follow the traditional RPN approach, one of the things you're going to go in there and do is go ahead and end up, use some particular scale for occurrences, let's say, some particular scale for severities, whatever standard you happen to look at, to classify items. In doing so, one of the things that I like to propose is that using occurrence scales like this doesn't make much sense. If I tell you low, the occurrence is low, what does that mean? Or does it mean the same thing to you and you? Well, what's unlikely? Is it 1 in 1 million or is it 1 in 10 million or 1 in 25 million? So I'd rather, if you're going to do that, at least give me some definition of what that means. You can still keep that and put that on the side and hide it. And at least I'm defining what each one of those means. Now, if you tell me what they mean, I could also take each one of those and even build a model out of it, right? Give me a probability and give me a time. The least I could do is build a constant failure rate model out of it. So I could equate that to something that makes sense in reliability terms. Now, here is where we're going to start deviating from the way we kind of normally do things. If I have an occurrence here that you gave me a 7 and you told me it was high, and it's 10 out of 100, and let's say based on that time frame, I have some exponential distribution that describes that. If later on I had data that actually described exactly how that happened based on some analysis I did, Why can't I flip those around? Why can't I replace it with real numbers? Why couldn't I just say, hey, I've got an object that actually filament burn, that caused, I know exactly how it happens. I don't need to rely on your list. So if I've got data that describes some of those items, by all means, I'll keep on replacing them with real data as I move forward and real models. Now, what I don't want to be doing is this. If you're going to look at an FME exercise, and if you're only doing the FME exercise as a check mark in the process, or print a nice document that you're going to put in a filing cabinet, it's a total waste of time. Absolutely zero reason doing it. Okay, that goes along with doing it after the fact. Getting a nice FMEA document printed and filed, basically useless. Okay, it's an information gathering activity. I do the information gathering activity so I can use the information. What I'm gonna do now is if I have at least the very basics of what I've mentioned I need to have at this point, there is a lot of stuff I can do with this. I can basically make a statement that I can take that and I can get you people that need it at different pieces of the organization, and there's different things they're gonna do with it. Even things you haven't even thought about doing. Obviously, from a reliability side, yeah, we need that. From a risk and safety guy, we need that. Maintenance planning guy. We're gonna do an RCM, do I need that? Of course I need that information. Even things you wouldn't think about. Guy does diagnostics. Why does a guy that does diagnostics need it? Well, if you give me a list of all the items, reliability items that can fail, their failure modes, their causes and their effects, can I reverse that and start from the effect and tell you, oh, light bulbs burned, these are the causes for it, and then automatically create diagnostics out of it using all the knowledge of the engineering team. And this is, again, where the savings are going to come from. Is there's a lot of activities we do that seem to be disconnected that require the same source of information. And just to kind of make that, a lot of what we do today, an FMEA, we only use it for the classical implementation. There is a lot of stuff out there that we could be using it for. And where is that?